Good morning, friends, and greetings in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Today, friends, we are blessed. We are blessed to be a people who worship. We worship together the God who is creator, redeemer, and sustainer. The one who is that living presence in each and every one of our lives, that living presence that drives us forward to love God, serve God, and share God with others. Today in our worship, may all these things be true and more, friends, as today we see several threads run throughout our service of worship. We see a thread of Reformation Sunday, an opportunity to celebrate and remember that God continues even today, still reforming the Church of Jesus Christ, the body of Christ at work in this world. Friends, we worship with a thread of All Saints Day, remembering together the great cloud of witnesses of which we are a part, those saints both above and below that give us guidance and strength and inspiration to share this journey of faith. In today's in-person worship service, we will celebrate the ordination and installation of new elders and deacons, celebrating God's call to leadership and ministry that still echoes in the walls and in the ministry of this church still today. And friends, all of these threads are bound together by an overarching message from the book of Ruth. This reminder that we are not called to go alone into this world, but that we are called to make God's people our people, to go where God lives, to make that our home, to know that we are God's people, that all of us together are God's people, and that God is our God, and together we will do great and wonderful things. Friends, that is the joy that calls us together to worship today, in spirit and in truth. Friends, on behalf of the people and the ministry of the Old First Presbyterian Church in Huntington, New York, I welcome each and every one of you and invite you into this time of worship. May this time inspire greatness in your heart and in your spirit, as together we are brought with sisters and brothers in Christ to give glory and honor and praise to the name of our God this day and every day. Friends, let us worship God together, the God of our Reformation, the God of our saints that have gone before, the God who inspires our leadership still today, the God who is with us always. Friends, may we be called to worship today through these words adapted from the West Street Christian Church in Tipton, Indiana. Come, ye saints of God, come to a new heaven and a new earth. Come to the holy city, God's new Jerusalem. The dwelling place of God is with humanity. God wipes away the tears from our eyes. Friends, the earth is the Lord's and belongs to God, all of creation and all who dwell within it. Who shall ascend the mountain of God? Who shall stand in God's holy place? Friends, all with clean hands and pure hearts will know God's eternal love, grace, and forgiveness. We give thanks to God, who has invited us to share in the inheritance of all the saints. Friends in Christ, living our lives surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, the saints both above and below, and overjoyed to be part of a church family that is constantly being formed and reformed by the Spirit of God at work among us, let us lift our hearts and our voices as together we share today's opening hymn, one of the great Reformation hymns of all time, A Mighty Fortress Is Our God.
Thank you.
Friends in Christ, today's first reading is from the book of Ruth, chapter 1, verses 1 through 18. Friends, as we listen to this scripture that marks the beginning of Ruth's story, I invite us to listen together for a couple of items that we see God sharing with us in this reading. The first is this idea of how Ruth's story begins. She is called to be part of a large family of faith, and one by one that family is taken away until all that is left is her and her mother-in-law. And friends, as Naomi speaks to her daughter-in-law, Ruth, and tells her to go and make something of herself, to go and leave her alone, friends, also listen for how Ruth chooses to respond. And this wonderful and beautiful affirmation of being present with those who are lost and alone. And think, friends, about how God makes that same pledge to each one of us. Friends, I invite us to listen together for God's word from the book of Ruth, chapter 1, verses 1 through 18. In the days when the judges ruled, there was a famine in the land. And a certain man of Bethlehem in Judah went to live in the country of Moab, he and his wife and two sons. The name of the man was Elimelech, and the name of his wife Naomi. And the names of his two sons were Mahlon and Chilion. They were Ephrathites from Bethlehem in Judah. They went into the country of Moab and remained there. But Elimelech, the husband of Naomi, died, and she was left with her two sons. These took Moabite wives. The name of one was Orpah, and the name of the other Ruth. When they had lived there about 10 years, both Mahlon and Chilion also died, so that the woman was left without her two sons and her husband. Then she started to return with her daughters-in-law from the country of Moab. For she had heard in the country of Moab that the Lord had considered his people and given them food. So she set out from the place where she had been living, she and her two daughters-in-law, and they went on their way to go back to the land of Judah. But Naomi said to her two daughters-in-law, "Go back, each of you, to your mother's house. May the Lord deal kindly with you as you have dealt with the dead and with me. The Lord grant that you may find security, each of you, in the house of your husband." Then she kissed them and wept aloud. They said to her, "No, we will return with you to your people." But Naomi said, "Turn back, my daughters. Why will you go with me? Do I still have sons in my womb that they may become your husbands? Turn back, my daughters, go your way, for I am too old to have a husband. Even if I thought there was hope for me, even if I should have a husband tonight and bear sons, would you then wait until they were grown? Would you then refrain from marrying? No, my daughter. It has been far more bitter for me than for you, because the hand of the Lord has turned against me." Then they wept aloud again. Orpah kissed her mother-in-law, but Ruth clung to her. So she said, "See, your sister-in-law has gone back to her people and to her gods. Return after your sister-in-law." But Ruth said, "Do not press me to leave you, or to turn back from following you. Where you go, I will go. Where you lodge, I will lodge. Your people shall be my people, and your God, my God. Where you die, I will die. There will I be buried. May the Lord do thus and so to me, and more as well, if even death parts me from you." When Naomi saw that she was determined to go with her, she said no more to her. Friends, the grass withers and the flower fades, but the word of our Lord endures forever. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Now, friends, I invite all of our young disciples who are worshiping together with us today to gather closer to their screens, as together we share a special time thinking and reflecting about this moment in Scripture, where Ruth is faced with a choice to either leave Naomi alone or to stand in solidarity with her. And friends, in looking at how Ruth responds to Naomi, may we together, as young disciples, as a church family, think about how we are called to stand with others this day and every day. So young disciples, draw close as together we share a special time with one another. A very special good morning and welcome to all of our fabulous young disciples who are worshiping together with us today. Friends, today we get an opportunity to think together about one of the great stories of the Old Testament, the story of Ruth and Naomi. And friends, just a few short moments ago, we shared the beginning of their story. And it's a story that echoes some themes that you and I know pretty well. Friends, as Naomi experiences a great loss in her life, she looks at her daughter-in-law, Ruth, and she says to her, "Look, you're young. You have a lot of life to live. I want you to go out and live it and leave me alone." Naomi has experienced great loss. She feels terribly alone. She feels abandoned by God, and she just wants to be on her own. And friends, have you ever felt like that? Have you ever had one of those days where you wake up and you just don't want to be around anybody? You're in a bad mood. You feel like everything's gone wrong. You feel like nothing's going right, and you just say, "Leave me alone." And sometimes, friends, that's not just something that we ask people to do. It's something that we really feel deep down inside. We've all had those moments where we feel like no one understands us, that there's no one out there that has experienced what we experience, and we just feel alone. We feel like there is no one in our lives that knows how we feel. And friends, that can be a very lonely feeling. And I know some of you have experienced that before. Some of you may be experiencing that right now today. And surely, friends, all of us will experience that at some point in our lives. And friends, those are the moments when I want us to remember how Ruth responds to her mother-in-law. Ruth could have said, "You're right, Naomi, I have better things to do, you are miserable, and I am going to leave you alone," and she could have gone home. But she didn't, friends. Remember Ruth's response. She said, "I am not going anywhere unless I am going with you. Where you go, I will go. Where you live, I will live. Your people will be my people, your God will be my God, and I will be with you always, right up until the moment where you are not with me anymore." And friends, that is who God is calling us to be. God is calling us to be a people who share the journey of life together. It is why we are part of a church family. It is why we have friends and family that we share this journey of faith with. Because friends, just like God never leaves us alone, we are not called to leave each other alone. So when you feel like there's nobody else that understands you, yes, you may go to God and know that God is always with you. But friends, know that you also have a church family who will be right there with you as well. And friends, if you see someone in your life, if you see a friend or a classmate or a family member who's having one of those days where they just feel like they want to be left alone and that nobody understands them, feel free to say to them, I respect that, but know that you're not alone because I'm with you. I care for you, I love you, and God loves you. And I'm going to be right here when you need me. Friends, that is the power of who we are called to be as children of God, as disciples of Jesus Christ, as servants of the Holy Spirit, that there is no time when we have to be alone or leave others alone because we are called to be with people, no matter how they feel or no matter how alone they may be. We are called to be with those, to share life together, to share love, to share God together. And friends, if we can do that, then there is no stopping us when it comes to how we can share God's love. Friends, let us say a prayer together and we'll ask for God's help. You can repeat after me. Dear God, we give you thanks that you have called us not to be alone, and not to leave others alone, but to be with each other, sharing this life, sharing our faith, sharing our love, and sharing our God. Help us do this every day of our lives. In Jesus' name, and together, friends, may we say, amen. Well, friends, know if you are feeling alone today, that your church family is with you. And if you see people who are out there feeling alone, stand with them so that they may know that we share this life. That our life is their life, that our God is their God, that their people are our people, and we are in this journey together. Thanks be to God, as together we say, amen. Friends in Christ, today's second reading is from the Gospel of Mark, chapter 12, verses 28 through 34. Friends, in this moment in the life and ministry of our Christ, we have a description of a wonderful conversation that happens between one of the scribes and Jesus. And it's not entirely sure if this is a real, open, honest question or if this is just another opportunity for someone to challenge Jesus. But yet, friends, regardless of what drives that question, Jesus' answer is clear about what is to be important in our lives. And again, friends, how we are called to live in ways that show our love for God and for one another, not by isolating ourselves, but by standing with, loving those that have been put into our paths. So friends, let us listen together for God's word from the Gospel of Mark, chapter 12, beginning with verse 28. One of the scribes came near and heard them disputing with one another. And seeing that he answered them well, he asked Jesus, "Which commandment is the first of all?" Jesus answered, "The first is, 'Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, and with all your soul, and with all your mind, and with all your strength. And the second is this, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. There is no other commandment greater than these.' Then the scribe said to him, 'You are right, teacher, You have truly said that he is one, and besides him there is no other. And to love him with all the heart and with all the understanding and with all the strength, and to love one's neighbor as oneself. This is much more important than all whole burnt offerings and sacrifices. When Jesus saw that he had answered wisely, he said to him, "You are not far from the kingdom of God." After that, no one dared to ask him any questions. Friends, the grass withers and the flower fades, but the word of our Lord endures forever. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Now, friends, I must confess that at the beginning stages of planning for today's message, I was struck by a bit of anxiety, doubt maybe, about which direction we should follow. After all, today finds us sharing together in a service of worship with at least three threads that run throughout the service. Three themes that at first glance seem to have absolutely nothing to do with one another. So which one should we follow? Which theme should be lifted up in today's message? I wondered, was there, is there, or will there be any way of tying it all together? Should our focus be Reformation Sunday, an opportunity to proclaim with joy the great hallmarks of the church reformed and always reforming? Maybe we could read Martin Luther's 95 Theses, or talk about the prominence of the great battle cries of this time in the life of the church that endure still today. God alone, Christ alone, Scripture alone, grace alone, faith alone. Should that be our focus? Or should it be All Saints' Day, an opportunity to remember with great joy the faith and lives of all those who have gone before us? Generation after generation of people of faith, both in our lives and within our church family, who have shown us over time through thought, word, and deed what it looks like to live as Christ's faithful disciples. What it looks like to be God's people in service to the world, to remember the great role models in our lives, both the living and the departed, those saints above and below who have lived in ways that make Jesus Christ real for us. Or should our focus be on this new season of faith and leadership, where God calls 18 newly elected elders and deacons to share in a new beginning in today's in-person worship service? Should we be lifting up the joy of our common calling in Jesus Christ, our call to live lives worthy of the calling to which we have been called, both leading and following in the life of faith, answering that great and wonderful call to leadership, hearing the voice of God and responding with great joy and faithfulness, "Here I am, Lord, send me." Friends, each one of these special moments, seasons in the life of faith, each one of these themes, the Reformation, the church, the body of Christ, eternally being formed and reformed in the image of God, All Saints' Day, this opportunity to rejoice and give thanks for all who have kept the faith, finished their race, and who now rest from their labors, and the ordination and installation of new men and women in leadership who have been called into seasons of using their gifts, skills, and talents to lead our church family for such a time as this. Friends in Christ, each of these themes provides a rich and powerful message of faithfulness. Each one introduces a message that we would be blessed to worship around. But how do we choose? How do we determine? How do we decide which one wants to speak most powerfully today? Thank God, friends, that there was ultimately no choice. Because here in the lectionary, we were given two wonderful readings, one from the book of Ruth and the other from the Gospel of Mark. For friends, as we live our lives, yes, longing to know what God's greatest commandment may be, but also, friends, to live the reality of that commandment day in and day out so that we may know deep in our hearts, deep in our spirits, that we are indeed honoring God with every thought, every word, and every deed. Every opportunity to live more fully into the gift of faith at work in our hearts and our lives. And friends, as we look out into a world filled with far too many people who feel like they are living this life all by themselves, silently or vocally drowning in a sea of isolation and desperation, longing to know that somewhere out there are people who love them. Somewhere there are a people who care for them, who long to walk with them and beside them, assuring them that no matter how it feels, they are never alone. We find in these two scripture readings that thread that I was anxious to find, that thread that runs directly through the heart of all three of those themes and so much more, friends. Most powerfully in the words that Ruth speaks to Naomi as her mother-in-law desperately tries to push her away and leave her alone. We know the story, right, friends? We shared the beginning of that story together this morning. Naomi and Elimelech have taken their two sons to Moab in the hopes of a better life. Each one of their sons marries a Moabite woman, Orpah and Ruth, and together they seek out their fortune. But something bad happens. Elimelech dies, and Naomi is left a widow. But not to worry, because she has her two sons to take care of her, right? Wrong. Because both of her sons die as well, and now, friends, Naomi is alone. Naomi has nothing. And by alone, friends, we don't just mean that she is lonely, missing her husband and her sons. We mean that she has no one. No one to share life's journey with, no one to talk to, no one to eat with, no one, friends. She is entirely and completely without hope, for in this time in the life of God's people, there may just be nothing worse than being a widow. No home, no family, no livelihood, no way to make money or put food on the table, no prospect for life to improve over time, just sheer and total nothingness. A widow without sons, Naomi was more or less at the bottom of society's barrel, completely dependent on someone else to give her life. Now, loving her daughters-in-law too much to allow them to share in this same hopeless fate, Naomi begs them to leave her. She tells them to go back to their homes, to begin again, to find new husbands and build new lives, to forget about her. And eventually, Orpah sees the wisdom of this, gives her a kiss, and leaves. But Ruth refuses. And friends, in one of the most moving declarations of love and faithfulness, one of the most powerful statements of devotion and care, of passion and commitment anywhere in the entire biblical witness, Ruth refuses to leave Naomi and says instead, "Do not tell me to leave you. Where you go, I will go. Where you live, I will live. Your people will be my people. Your God will be my God. Where you die, I will die, and there will I be buried. And may the Lord punish me if even death parts me from your side." Friends, could there be a more powerful response to someone in our lives who is pushing us away, Someone in our lives, someone in our world who is feeling lost and alone and just wants to wallow in that loneliness. Could there be a more powerful response as a people of faith? Could there be a more powerful way for us to live God's greatest commandment in Jesus Christ? To love the Lord our God with all of our heart, mind, soul, and strength, and love our neighbors as we love ourselves. Think about it, friends. What if God calls us today to follow God, and our answer is Ruth's answer? God, where you go, I will go. Where you live, I will live. Your people will be my people, and nothing will separate us, not even death itself. And what if, friends? What if we hear God's call to love our neighbors, and today our answer is Ruth's answer? Oh, I will show you my love for my neighbor. Where my neighbor goes, I will go. Where they live, I will live. Their people will be my people, their God, my God, and not even death will keep me from letting them know that they are not alone. Friends, that is powerful stuff. What a powerful way to guide and shape our lives. Because friends, we are first and foremost in our lives a people who are called to love our God. And then secondly, friends, to love our neighbors as we love ourselves. And I propose today that there can be no greater love than for us to willingly choose to stand in the gaps of people's lives. Especially, friends, in those moments when they feel like everything else is lost, when everyone else has turned their back on them, when they feel lost and alone, when they are at their wits' ends, when they believe there is no one else out there in their lives that cares for them, when the world stands against them and they have been shut out of the joys of life and it feels like there is nothing left. The Naomis of our lives. And friends, make no mistake, those people exist today. Those people who represent the ones that society has placed on the bottom of the barrel, those who feel left out, shut out, and kept out for any number of reasons. And we all know the list, right? We see it in the news every day. They're left out. They feel shut out because of their gender or their race, their ethnicity or their sexuality, their socioeconomic status, their reputation, profession, or level of education, or because maybe of their mental, physical, or emotional health. The ones battling the power of addiction in many different ways. Those lost in depressive thoughts of self-harm or suicide. We know, friends, the voices and experiences that have been and continue to be pushed aside in our world, shut out of the life of the church. But we also know, if we are honest, friends, about the highest calling of our lives in Jesus Christ, that there on the fringes of life, there among those the world has brushed aside and forgotten, there among those that the world says that we have every right to turn our backs on and leave behind, there, friends, is where we are called to go, and there is where we are called to love. And friends, that is the place, right there in our call to be present and to love, where those three themes that seem so divergent all come together. The church, reformed and always reforming, is built around our commitment to be with those in need and to love them through whatever need they may have. Our desire to honor the saints of our lives by living in ways that share those great lessons of faith they have taught us is fulfilled when we choose to walk beside those the world has forgotten. loving God by loving neighbor, so that together we may see God's kingdom come on this earth. And friends, the opportunity we share to join in the ministry of the church, led by those whom God has called to lead us, is built upon a foundation of worship, fellowship, and mission that inspires us to stand with those who most desperately long to know that they are loved, and that no matter what the world tells them, the church assures them that they are never alone. Friends, where they go, we must go. Where they live, we must also live. Those people must be our people. So that together, friends, we may learn to love the Lord our God with all of our heart, mind, soul, and strength, and we may learn to love our neighbors even as we love ourselves. That is the church reformed and reforming. That is the church living into our call to be saints of God for the people of God. That is our call to leadership and to follow in ministry. The privilege, the opportunity, the joy of tying it all together by standing with and loving all God's people. Friends, thanks be to our God, as together God's joyful and joy-filled people say, Amen.
Thank you.
Friends in Christ, as we seek to commit, to pledge our lives to living in ways that allow the world to know that we do not stand apart from those in need, but stand with them, to stand with those who long to know that they are not alone, so that our people may be their people, our God their God, our place to live their place to live. There is no more powerful way for God's people to do this with one another and with the world than to stand together in times of prayer, to bow our heads and hearts together, to submit our wills to the will of God, to speak and to listen for how God is calling us to be with those in need, to lift their needs above our own, to show our love for God and our love for neighbor by humbling ourselves in prayer. Friends, I invite us to do that together in the gift of this time and this space, as together we bow in prayer and lift the prayers of our hearts into the presence of our God. Friends, as we pray together, may we listen for these words: God of unconditional love and eternal guidance, and may we answer in faithful prayer, speak into our lives today and show us your path. Friends, together let us bow with one another in a time of prayer. Enduring God, on this Reformation Sunday, we thank you today for your faithfulness to us and to the tradition that has shaped us as followers of Jesus Christ. We thank you for your living word, which continues to reveal him still today, and for the gift of your Spirit to help us interpret your wisdom in the midst of challenging times. God of the Reformation, constantly bringing us together, forming us and reforming us in your image in this time of silent prayer, may you show us the ways you are calling us to be formed and reformed today. God of unconditional love and eternal guidance, speak into our lives today and show us your path. Eternal God, on this day marking the faithfulness of your saints, we give you thanks for people in our lives and across the ages who have shown us your loving kindness through their witness to Christ Jesus, in so many different places and in so many different situations. Inspire us by their examples and show us how we too may live our faith in the midst of challenging times. Gracious God, we give you thanks for the saints above and the saints below. And in the gift of this silence, we speak the names that are part of our great cloud of witnesses in each of our lives. God of unconditional love and eternal guidance, speak into our lives today and show us your path. Loving God, you keep calling us to care for those in need and to show hospitality to strangers in our midst. We thank you for your persistent love, which continues to comfort and challenge us all. Open our hearts and eyes so that we may see how to offer that love to others in the midst of challenging times. God of unconditional love and eternal guidance, speak into our lives today and show us your path. God of inspiration and guidance, we lift before you those new elders and deacons who are being ordained and installed today in the life of our church family. We ask for your Spirit to be upon them in mind, body, and spirit, that the dreams they dream and the opportunities they provide for us to live into the calling you have placed upon our hearts and lives may be truly ordained of you and your Spirit. God, in the midst of challenging times, give them the strength and inspiration to lead your people in worship, in fellowship, and mission for such a time as this. God of unconditional love and eternal guidance, speak into our lives today and show us your path. Wise and compassionate God, hear us now in this time of silent prayer, as we lift before you the names of people and places that are on our hearts, minds, and spirits this day. We lift before you the names of all who long to know your healing presence in mind, body, and spirit. Those who mourn and long to be comforted. Those who rejoice and long for people to share the joy with them. God, give us the strength to know who these people are in our lives, and to speak their names with bold confidence and joy today. God of unconditional love and eternal guidance, speak into our lives today and show us your path. Show us your path, O God, in the midst of challenging times. For in these challenging times, there are countless ways to respond with your love, your grace, your mercy, and your power. Hear us now as we continue to pray together, lifting our voices with the followers of Jesus the Christ in every time and in every place through the words he taught us all to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Friends in Christ, we have come together in the gift of this time and this space to worship God together in spirit and in truth. Friends, may the gift of these times together, may the gift of our worship drive us out from these times and out from these places to love God, to serve others in the name of Jesus Christ, and to share the power of the Holy Spirit with a world in need. So that regardless of what it is that speaks to our hearts today, whether it is that call that God continues to form and reform us in a daily reformation, or if it is that call to remember those who have gone before and those who continue to live as saints above and below, or whether it is the excitement and joy of calling new leadership into the life and ministry of the church, may we know that regardless of how we live and where we live, that we are called to be with God's people. So that where we live is where they live. Their people are our people, that our God is their God, so that together we may proclaim that we are not alone. Friends, may we go about these tasks uplifted by the love of God, nourished by the life of Jesus Christ, and inspired by the power and presence of the Holy Spirit now and forevermore. Thanks be to our God, as together God's people say, Amen.
Praise God from whom blessings flow. Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.